It's been a while.
Has it? It hasn't been that long.
Yeah.
It hasn't been that long.
Like 1.5 months, you know, that's kind of long by our standards. What's been going on with you guys?
Well, I got fired from the podcast. I wasn't informed of it, and then there was another episode that went up, and you know, I saw it in my sub box, and I was like, "What the hell? Like, what happened?" Like, I contacted Mark's lawyer. We got it all straightened out. It was a legal misunderstanding, and I am back. I am happy, and I am ready to go. No bad blood here. No T-Swift. I don't know. I'm excited. I'm glad to be back.
Listen, man. You were, like, moving and crap. Did you want to bring down the quality of your podcast with your exhaustion? I didn't think so.
The quality of the podcast is, you know, better, you know, bettered whenever yours truly, a.k.a. the internet's second busiest music nerd.
I think that was Spectrum Pulse, actually.
The third busiest YouTube music nerd. There we go. That limits it a little bit.
I went on vacation.
Where did you go?
I was in your neckish of the woods. I was in Virginia. I was out visiting my parents.
Don't say hey.
Well, I was like still like I was in Northern Virginia, so I was like still yeah,
like DC almost area.
Yeah, it was in pretty much on the outskirts of DC.
Gotcha.
And I got bit by my parents' 250-pound mastiff.
Oh.
In the side. It was fun. Other than that, it was great.
Yeah, at first, I just heard I was bit by my parents.
I mean that isn't uncommon. My family's crazy.
The audio was flipping in and out. I mean, it could have been that. It could have been the actual dog. Yeah. We're not sure.
Yeah.
Find out on the next podcast whenever Johnny goes in Phil.
Yeah. I mean, and on my way back, I was also searched by the TSA again. So that's always fun.
Wow.
Yes. They've taken my toothpaste on multiple occasions.
That's why you don't bring a toothpaste on a flight.
Yeah, Mark, you're the only person I know that brushes his teeth, like, before and after he lands. I don't understand. Like, whenever we met back in July, whenever he shows up, he gets in the car and breaks out the toothbrush. That's the first thing.
Guys.
Oh, yeah, who doesn't?
John, I want to show you the podcast, but first I got to brush my teeth.
You remember.
People can smell that breath through the YouTube player. It's essential. Okay, so, and as for me, it's probably not as eventful, you know, just a college kid doing finals. It's tiring.
Way to bring down the mood.
Yeah, dog attacks since TSA, it's not depressing enough. Now I gotta throw student and crippling anxiety into it?
Yeah, like, let me guess, you're getting student loans. Way to rack up the national debt even more.
I got a fee waiver.
You got what?
No, I got a fee waiver. My dad's a veteran.
Oh, I thought you said a full scholarship.
You never know if that'll happen. I haven't transferred yet.
Where are you planning on?
I mean, I could like check. I could like there was like a thing on the websites for college applications. I'd check off, you know, the Caucasian one, the diabetic one,
The race car.
The San Diego one. There's just every single demographic one. So.
You know, I just don't know if I can be on a podcast with someone who plays the race card like this.
I can't be on a podcast with a white person, Mark. I just gotta.
Yeah. Like Caucasian? Like, how dare you?
Yeah.
Welcome to the Mad Sounds Podcast. Where we talk about music related things mostly. It can go other places. Who knows? I'm Mark.
I'm John. Jonathan, whatever you know me by.
And I'm Johnny Jonathan, the person who's also the same name.
Yep, they are the Johnny Bunch. And by the way, guys, I haven't really mentioned this at the beginning of an episode before, but if you guys don't want to listen to this all on YouTube, want to download it onto your phone or whatever device the kids are using nowadays, then there is a link in the description. Go to a website where you can convert this to an MP3 and do what you like with that.
The kid.
Give it a boom.
Says the kid. I don't know what the kids are using these days. Oh,
yep.
I don't know.
Yep. The guy that was in third grade when American Idiot came out, and you're having legitimate conversations with him.
Hmm. That really puts it in perspective, doesn't it, Johnny?
Yeah, it does. I was in middle school.
Now, we're the same age, right? You and I?
I think. I'm 23.
Same. Okay. Yeah, okay. So, all right. See, okay. We don't understand Mark and where he's coming from. He's all about this new demographic that he's trying to reach. He's like a huge Halsey follower into the Justin Biebers and Selena Gomez.
No, Justin Bieber is so 2010.
Oh, okay. Wow, we're that dated. Wow. We think that Justin Bieber is still a thing.
Yeah.
Whew.
Like, really, what are you listening to now? Freaking Magic, Gautier.
Magic? That's your go-to?
They're so... Year ago.
Santa Gold,
there you go. I'd listen to that over Magic.
Yeah.
Wait, we're talking about Magic the Band or Magic the Gathering?
No. I'm sure Magic the Gathering is something that your generation is more familiar with. Anyway.
Yeah.
So what have you guys been listening to over the past few weeks since we've joined, or the past few months? It's been a while.
Been a while, huh?
Well, I've been kind of rounding out 2015 albums just to kind of make my list as whole as it could be from my perspective, along with finishing up this continuation I've been doing where I do, it's called Listography. It's a long top 10 of every year in music. So I was also listening to like late 70s albums, because that's where I left off. I've been listening to albums from 1979 through 1977.
Nice.
So backwards.
Yeah, it's going backwards. I've been listening to a lot of Kraftwerk, because they are pretty highly regarded. Mm-hmm. And the Bowie. I've been on a huge Bowie kick lately.
Because of his new album, which we're going to get to
in
our segment where we talk about albums we're looking forward to for next year.
Well, way to spoil it. I mean, dang.
Should have let me go last. I'm a transitive property segue machine.
I mean, I've been doing a lot of the same stuff, John. I know that you're pretty much done with this year's stuff since you put out your video. But I've been just, like, catching up on a bunch of stuff. I've checked out everything from... I went from Adele to Bring Me the Horizon to Casey Musgraves in a week.
That's a hell of a week.
Yep. Yeah. And I'm going to get into this in a little bit when we talk about the Grammys and the R segment we're doing on this podcast.
Oh my God, and this man cannot stop spoiling things.
He can't.
It's called previews to make sure they stick around, you know? There might have been these guys are just talking about random things, but wait, they're going to be talking about the Grammys? That's an important pop culture thing.
He definitely doesn't have the timestamps in the description.
They don't know about timestamps.
We have a stamp collection, and it's very private.
And it's in the description.
And it's in the description.
And there's just a bunch of stamps with clocks on them. Time stamps.
Yeah, that's why he was talking about, what was it, the clockwork, Kraftwerk? He meant clockwork, that's what he was talking about.
I'm trying to tie it all together.
I was done with this year, but I'm not quite done. There's one other album that I'm planning to still check out this year, but as far as I go with my year-end list, I don't count December releases counting towards the current year. I count them towards, this year will go towards 2016, so I still have Cage the Elephant and Pusha T to get to.
Okay, and you know what? You're probably better off. Now, I'm wondering, are you going to include the worst albums from December? Because December has been, my God.
No December albums. No December albums.
Because we've got, and I'm going to do, I think I'm going to do, a whole video on Kid Cudi at this point. So I'm not going to spoil my thoughts here.
Maybe I should make an exception.
Yeah.
Because of that.
Yeah.
And the album that John and I probably disagree the most on, Coldplay.
Yeah.
I do not like that album at all.
Yeah, we did disagree on that. I've been seeing some positive reviews around the interwebs, though. You know, there's other people that like it. There's people who dislike it. I'm glad that I like it, you know, because, I heard Adventure of a Lifetime, the first single, and I wasn't convinced at first. But then I really started getting it. It's not going to be on my top 50 songs of the year list. Don't expect that.
Good, good.
Any Coldplay songs. But still, I really enjoyed the record as a whole. It's just really fun for me to listen to.
Yeah. I think they just wasted, like, all their guests. Like,
man, how can you argue that Tovlo sounded great with Chris Martin and Beyonce?
He's just a backing singer.
Okay, Beyonce harmonizing with Chris Martin? No?
They didn't really give him much of a feature, really.
Well, Beyonce wasn't technically a feature. Tovlo was the only actual featured guest.
Was a feature. Like, even if it doesn't say it on the track list on the back cover, it's a feature.
Well, so is every time DJ Mustard produces a track, then.
As is deserved. The man is a visionary.
He has a jar of mustard blinged out on his chain. And that is deserving of all the credits.
The mustard's on the beat, ho.
Oh my god, what if he named himself DJ Mustard after the color of gold? Oh my god.
And all the monies.
Yeah. Okay.
Speaking of gold, the Grammys!
Yes! Ah! I do love all of my Grammy Awards that I've been nominated for so far. The best... Yeah. What was it? Best music critic, best YouTube alternative, something.
Craziest hair in the vlogging sphere.
Best yes. teeth in the game.
Yeah.
That's just an honorary thing to.
I got nominated in all categories, but lost in all of them in previous years. So.
Yeah.
Okay, and now that you mention it, by the way, I'd like to announce here that I'm going to be doing a segment later this month as a catch-up thing. It's called Reviews in Haikus, of course, Jack Stone's inspired.
Okay.
I'm going to be doing reviews in haikus. Just a little...
Now, could you speak your next thought in the form of a haiku, please?
I don't really know. That is kind of hard to do. Can we transition?
Yes.
That was not a true haiku, because the second line was 8 syllables, and you did not end
it
with
seven.
It snowing
that was
on
seven.
Mount Fuji.
You know, I don't want
to
be...
That was kind of hard to do. That was seven.
Kind of hard to... Oh, yeah, it was. Mm. I miscounted.
Talking it hard.
That was a pun on something that was cut out. Thank you for that.
They don't know that there was a cut.
They don't know there was a cut.
That was just a random Walk the Moon reference.
Mock, you're fired. You're fired, man. You're fired.
No, listen, man, in order to increase relatability with them, they have to know, they have to be transparent, you know? Then we
make
the money
jokes
from the fandom.
All the monies. DJ Mustard, he makes the monies. You're not making the monies.
Are you saying Marky on the beat? No, you're not.
Grammys.
Yes.
Grammys.
Screw segues.
There's lots of nominees.
Okay, so the Grammys this year, we're going to get into in a little bit, but personally, I think it's getting, like, the standards of the Grammys are kind of low, but in the grand scheme of things, but compared to the last years, it's not that bad.
I think they've gotten better the past 2 years. This year better than last, but
yeah,
I think it's not that bad.
Yeah, I mean, if you think about, like, the last couple artists to win the Album of the Year, there was Beck last year, hell yeah. And then Daft Punk the year before, at least in that category, they've been pretty consistently good.
And if they continue with it this year, it'll be even better.
Yeah.
Keep it going.
So how it's gonna work is that I got the Grammy website pulled up here, and what we're gonna do is we're gonna go through the nominees of just all the ones we care about, basically, and we're gonna decide on our collective choice, despite disagreements, just gonna narrow down one choice, and then our prediction for who we actually think is going to win.
Before we get into this, can I ask a question that I have legitimately been asking myself since I saw this Grammy list?
Go ahead.
Yes.
What is the difference between record and song of the year?
Okay, the way I've noticed is that song of the year is more about songwriting, so it go to the song to the writers of the song. Whereas, of course, the artist would go on stage. Whereas, record of the year is more of an overall thing,
like
to kind of producing and instrumentation, and that's more of an overall thing.
Right. If you notice under Song of the Year on the Grammy website, you'll see that like all of the songwriters are listed and that sort of thing, whereas Record of the Year is just the artist.
Okay. Yeah, I'm seeing that. I'm seeing that.
Okay, so let's get this thing started. First one on the list here is Record of the Year. There is Really Love by D'Angelo, Uptown Funk by Mark Ronson, Bruno Mars, Thinking Out Loud by Ed Sheeran, Blank Space by Taylor Swift, and Can't Feel My Face by The Weeknd. Now, personally, I think for my choice, I'm going between Uptown Funk and Can't Feel My Face.
I would agree. I would agree with those. Although I would probably favor Can't Feel My Face, to be honest.
Is it just because of the overplaying from Uptown Funk?
Yes.
Okay. Johnny, what would you?
I am torn, actually, between three, as weird as it sounds. The two you guys said, and Blank Space, just because that song was literally, Mark, I'm using literally in the actual term that you like to hear it.
Good.
It was what I listened to for, like, 3 weeks straight, and I don't normally do that with pop songs, so...
Yeah, I mean, it's good. It's good, for sure.
Very good. It's very
one
good.
Of, one of her better songs, even from someone that's kind of ambivalent on her. But, just in terms of sheer replay value, I personally, I'm going Uptown Funk. What would you guys say? If you had to narrow down one?
Can't Feel My Face.
And I'll just say Blank Space to be the third.
Well, we got to decide on one.
Yes.
Then I'm gonna go with John because I love Can't Feel My Face. I've been on a weekend kick lately too. So
yeah.
Can't Feel My Face.
When I'm on this podcast.
And I love it.
I do.
And what do we think is going to win?
Can't Feel My Face.
I was just say honestly, it's probably gonna be either Ed Sheeran or Taylor Swift that's gonna win.
I wouldn't be surprised if it was Taylor Swift. Like I would be surprised if she didn't come away with something. But
yeah.
I also wouldn't be surprised if it was Uptown Funk just because it was such a ubiquitous song.
It was kind of like it was nationwide, worldwide type of thing. It was like a movement almost.
Yeah, and you know, it's kind of like that Daft Punk thing of like this artist that's been around for a long time, has gotten a lot of acclaim, just suddenly having this huge mainstream breakthrough in the U.S.
Thanks to Bruno.
Yeah, that too.
I think that we're going to go with a Blank Space for the prediction.
Yeah, I can agree with that. I think that Taylor is going to either come away with that or probably the next segment that you're going to mention or the next category, but we'll see.
The next one is Album of the Year. There is Sounding Color by Alabama Shakes, To Pimp a Butterfly by Kendrick Lamar, Traveler by Chris Stapleton, 1989 by Taylor Swift, and Beauty Behind the Madness by The Weeknd. It's got to be The Pimp a Butterfly.
Yeah, T-Bap all
the way. Yes, yes. Kendrick better sweep the Grammys or I will riot.
If not, we ain't gonna be all right.
Yeah, I was about to say, if hip-hop fans rioted over Macklemore winning over Kendrick, imagine Taylor Swift winning over Kendrick.
Or, I don't know. Well, I don't know. If someone like Chris Stapleton won, I don't think there would be as big of an uproar, but if T-Swift took that out from under Kendrick, I could see there'd be some big problems.
I mean, I can see that kind of having like the Beck angle of like the singer-songwriter kind of coming out of nowhere with this quaint little singer-songwriter record, but would you say it's both our choice and prediction, Pimp Butterfly?
I don't know if it's my prediction, necessarily. I think that 1989 has a very, 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 very good chance of winning. But...
I'm gonna go with To Pimp a Butterfly, if only because that record, it's not like 1989, where it has that like, incredibly... Like, I heard 1989's hype, and I heard its reception. I only hear To Pimp a Butterfly's reception on, like, a still kind of low-key level, if you get what I mean. Like, a lot of people love it, but they're not like, oh my god, sing it from the rooftops! Like, I don't know. I feel like To Pimp a Butterfly is gonna, like...
Well...
Yeah, I think it's just if you follow, like, hardcore music fan circles, they are like that. Like, they're calling this incredible classic, which it kind of is.
I feel like singing it from the rooftops, for me, would get me called a racist. So I for one will not be doing that, but
and speaking of Kendrick, we gotta say right now, 11 nominations.
Yes. slow
golf. That's also part of the reason why I think he's gonna. That's part of the reason why I think he's gonna sweep it, because he has so many nominations that like it's almost improbable for him to not win Album of the Year with Tim Pimple Butterfly.
Yeah. What would happen if he got snubbed on every single one of them?
I would be pissed as hell.
The world like,
I
would
have never been mad at the Grammys.
The Earth would fall out of orbit with the rest of the solar system.
Did you guys hear, this is random, but it just popped in my head, it's Grammy related. Did you hear that Drake's label forgot to submit one of his songs for submission to be eligible for the Grammy?
Oh, yeah.
Really? That's amazing.
Yeah.
Young Money.
Yeah, Young Money.
Isn't he so business savvy?
What'd you say?
Young Moolah, baby.
Oh, Young.
old Birdman's getting a little bird-brained.
that was good. That was a good part. I'll give you that. I don't normally give you that, but I'm going to give you that one.
I appreciate that. So, Song of the Year.
Yes.
Is We Gonna Be All Right by Kendrick Lamar.
Do we even need to go past that? Do we even need to go past that?
Yeah, no. We don't. We don't.
I think we can all agree.
White Space? Girl Crush? Girl Crush? Anyone?
No. All right. All right.
See You Again thing out loud?
I don't know, guys. See You Again. Kind of feeling it, you know?
I really hope it doesn't. Because that'd be kind of like a cheap, like, oh, because the celebrity died, like...
And we all feel guilty, so we're going to give it the Grammy.
Yeah. But it's not like Paul himself is winning the Grammy, so...
Yeah, I think All Right's going to win, and that's also my personal choice, so...
Yes.
I mean, I think All Right, it has a really good chance. Blank Space might, if I had to pick a second choice.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, so those would be the two. But I mean, All Right is mine. Like I can't no. Okay.
I cannot back it. Like you're gonna be seeing this in the top 10 of my songs of the year, right there.
Yeah. So both our choice and predictions, All Right.
Yes.
Now I feel like we shouldn't do like, too many like repeat ones, just to kind of mix things up a little.
Yeah.
But we gotta put multiple ones for Kendrick.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So best new artist, the Grammy curse. In a way, like I want to put Sam Hunt on here just so we never hear him again. So it's Courtney Barnett, James.
Not
Bay.
A new artist.
What?
Not a new artist.
Yeah. It's really just like best breakthrough artist.
I know. That's
honestly,
what it's,
yeah. Neither were Arcade Fire when they were submitted.
Or Skrillex.
Yeah.
Or Boney Bear.
Yeah, I know. Which is fine. Point that out every year.
For fun, when all their members had been in bands for over a decade.
Yeah, and they're like in their 30s now.
Yeah.
You know, I'm remembering artists.
Yeah. Okay, so Courtney Barnett, James Bay, Sam Hunt, Tori Kelly, and Meghan Trainor. I'm going James Bay.
Nose for me.
I'm gonna submit this in the same vein that you did. Or that you joked, just because I'm sick of hearing her, Meghan Trainor. Nothing against her as a person, because I don't know her as a person, but I'm kind of sick of hearing Meghan Trainor songs.
She sounds like a terrible person from that Dear Future Husband song.
Yeah, like
that's true.
Some sort of entrapment. You know, like you're signing a contract whenever you begin dating her. Like, yeah, I'm just going to sign my life away, so we're going to have to make sure everything's done a certain way for me. And just and that song rubbed me the wrong way.
I'm pretty sure... It would be. I think that if there was like a wild card one, it would probably be Courtney Barnett if they're going with like the indie pick.
Yeah,
but she's definitely like my second favorite pick. But James Bay put out like one of my. I'm not sure if you guys have heard his album, but it's one of my favorites of the year so far. And I've just been kind of a big fan of him all year. And that song Hold Back the River, like I don't know why it hasn't broken through over here. It's like been in the top 10 everywhere else in the world.
Yeah, and that's why I think that he stands a better chance than Courtney does, just because he has seen a lot of success, so I would say he's the wild card here, but as far as I actually, that's who I would probably pick to win. Like, I would want James Bay to win, but in reality, I think it's going to be either Meghan Trainor or Sam Hunt, yeah.
Okay, so we're going to go James Bay for the choice and Meghan Trainor for the prediction?
Yeah.
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 Oh, and by the way, guys, I'm gonna take like a screenshot of this chart and then like post it on my Facebook and Twitter pages, just so you guys can take a look at it.
Cool.
Like, so you can nice and like play along at home when the Grammys comes on.
Yay!
The bingo card. The Mad Sounds bingo card.
You need to post that closer to the Grammys, Mark. I don't know if anybody will remember to go back to it.
I'll repost it then.
The fast-moving world of the internet. Yeah. You know.
Okay, so best pop solo performance. There's Heartbeat Song by Kelly Clarkson. Love Me Like You Do by Ellie Goulding. Thinking Out Loud by Ed Sheeran. Blank Space with Taylor Swift and Can't Feel My Face. Either for both my choice and prediction, it's down to Blank Space or Can't Feel My Face. You guys?
Yeah. I definitely agree with that, and I'm honestly going to say that Can't Feel My Face is going to be both my prediction and my choice, because that song has that kind of Grammy throwback sound that they like to hearken to.
Yeah.
So I feel like that's what's going to win.
I think it'll win. I'd be a hypocrite if I didn't pick Can't Feel My Face again, because I can't in one category say, you know, oh, Can't Feel My Face, but this time I'm going to go with Blank Space, so I'm going to have to stick with Can't Feel My Face.
Yeah, so are you thinking that for both the choice and the prediction?
Yes.
And you know what, I feel like it'd be weird if the Weeknd didn't come home with one.
With as huge of a year as he had this year, there's no way he's not going home with at least one.
Yeah, that would be like a glaring... Like a
middle finger.
At Blank Space and Can't Feel My Face were also nominated for Record of the Year. What do you think this category is any different?
As far as what they're looking for.
Yeah. Between Record of the Year and Best Pop Solo Performance.
Yes.
Yeah.
I think they're different because one is basically reach. Record is like. Reach. It's like you guys were saying about Uptown Funk. Like, Uptown Funk might win because it was like a phenomenon. Everyone got Uptown Funked, you know? Uptown Funked them up.
Uptown Funk gave it to them.
Whereas...
Several times.
Yeah.
Wasn't always expecting but it happened.
And we didn't believe them, and then we just watched.
But with a pop solo performance, it's like it's more of, is it a good pop song? And Can't Feel My Face is a fantastic pop song.
Yeah.
Especially for the Grammys. Yeah,
so, best pop duo / group performance.
I'm excited for this one.
Yeah.
I'm sorry? Wait, I'm sorry, can you say that again?
Oh, I was just saying I'm excited for this one because I have a very strong voice. Right.
Okay. Ship to Wreck by Florence and the Machine. Sugar by Maroon 5. Uptown Funk by Mark Ronson featuring Bruno Mars, Bad Blood, and See You Again.
Ship to Wreck, all day, like, without a doubt. As far as my personal choice goes, do I think it will win? No. But we can always hope, right? Because, I mean, I really, really, really liked How Big, How Blue, How Beautiful. Probably my favorite Florence record to date. And Ship to Wreck was just kind of like the pinnacle of that for me, just because it really showcased the direction that they wanted the album to go in, like more of like a punchy alternative rock thing. Like instead of like kind of the chamber pop or just kind of some of the, I guess, more radio-friendly pop that we had seen from them in the past, pop rock. And it's kind of like a commanding song, and I just like how strong that she is on the track, so... obvious choice for me.
Yeah, you know, I kind of see it as like a return of like that straightforwardness that was only on like Kiss with a Fist or something like that.
Yes.
I definitely agree with that.
Yeah, it's kind of an interesting pick because I don't think it was ever on the Hot 100, so I'm surprised about that.
I think it was in the bottom 10, possibly.
Maybe. Honestly, I think I'm gonna give it to Uptown Funk. That was not intended. I'm thinking like maybe vote for Ship to Wreck and prediction Uptown Funk.
Oh, I agree with that, then. Yeah, absolutely. I vote for Ship to Wreck. I don't think it will win. As far as what will win, I think it's either Uptown Funk or Bad Blood, and then I'm going to give it to Uptown Funk.
Personally really wanted to say Bad Blood, but I was going to go with Ship to Wreck because I liked Bad Blood a lot. The Kendrick version is a lot better than the album version.
Oh, my.
Well, it's just on the basis
of... Sorry, John. I know.
It's
John,
just on the basis.
Sorry.
Kendrick's presence makes anything better.
Exactly. Kendrick's presence. He made the fucking Classic Man song.
He's so tame and held back.
his worst verse is better than a lot of token guest rappers' best verses.
I mean, you're exactly absolutely right, but I like the original Bad Blood, so.
I don't. I think it's boring.
Johnny, I thought we were 1989 pals.
We are, but I wish that the Kendrick version was on the album.
So that's why you're such a big fan of her. It's all coming together now. I see. You know what? I'm just gonna wait for Lorde to put out an album called 1996.
Now that will be
good. Because she's born the same year as me, so I hashtag relate.
Yeah, we got it, Mark. We got it. You're young.
Are we gonna get Lorde on the podcast too, so we can argue it between the two of you, old people versus youngins?
Versus the youngins. My high school English.
Exhibit A, this BuzzFeed article.
Yeah.
Are you trying to make me sick?
Best pop vocal album.
Yes.
Piece by piece. But why is Kelly Clarkson in this main nomination? Someone cares about that album. How big, how blue, how blue, how beautiful. I got it. By Florence and Machine. Uptown Special by Mark Ronson. 1989 by Taylor Swift. And Before This World by James Taylor.
If we're going entirely on vocals, which is pop vocal album.
That's how I think about it, yeah.
Then How Big, no doubt, because Florence so great on this almost entire record.
And what I thought was weird was Uptown Special, because that album is literally all guest singers.
Yeah, it's various artists, you know, you can't just you can't credit Mark Ronson with that. Yes, maybe.
I mean, sure Bruno Mars and Mystical did a fine job.
Some would disagree with the latter.
And they would be wrong.
Opinions can't be wrong, Mark.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
Okay, so our vote is Florence. Do you think 1989 is probably going to win?
Oh, definitely.
I think 1989 is going to win, but I mean, I'm going to vote for How Big, How Blue, How Beautiful.
Okay.
We seem to all be on the same page. Let's write Florence's name.
What?
No one got the blank space reference, really? Blank space, I'll write your name.
That's why I laughed.
Yeah, Johnny, I could tell Johnny got it, but...
You know what? I'm going to start up a Florence and Machine Taylor Swift mashup project, and it's going to be called Florence and the Big Machine.
Because that's her record label.
Oh. Yeah.
I'm so glad.
Are we doing
the podcast can...
Okay, there are some categories I'm skipping. So there's best dance recording, but I was thinking maybe we should go over best dance/electronic albums since I haven't heard any of these, but I know you guys have heard a couple of them. There's Our Love by Caribou, Born the Echoes by the Chemical Brothers. I know you read that, John. Caracal by Disclosure, In Color by Jamie XX, and Jack U.
Yeah, I heard all of those except for Caribou. Never heard that one. Disclosure record did nothing for me. Jack U was very, very, very hit and miss. Did not.
It was the shit.
I have Febreze on it.
You should have Febreze on it.
I don't understand people who commented like saying that you don't understand the song's so supposed to be stupid. There's plenty of stupid songs that I like. Not I'm the shit. I should have Febreze on me. Are you kidding me?
And you know, I just don't like the argument that, and this is tangent, but I just don't like the argument that you shouldn't take it seriously because it's meant to be a joke, but it's not funny.
It's not.
No.
It's not clever.
There's a reason why there's a comedy genre of music, because people who make jokes make funny music.
Like The Lonely Island, or...
Let Them Do
It. Now.
Yeah.
Jeez, Ninja dude. Sex Party.
Yeah.
Yes, I'm not too familiar with them. I've only heard a few songs, but I'm gonna throw Gwar out there because isn't there element to some of them?
Kinda. I haven't heard much from them, but I feel like it's more of an image-wise. That's kind of comedy. I could be wrong.
It is also you have to look at it as these guys are having fun. It's like if Cannibal Corpse didn't take themselves seriously. That is Gwar.
There you go.
And they're not. Yeah. That's,
I've been to one of their live shows. I know how crazy that is. So
yes, that's what I mean. Yeah.
So we're gonna say. So which one are you gonna say, guys?
Jamie
I'm Sex, personally. I'm going to personally, I mean, this is also because, spoiler for a video that I'm doing that's coming out on my channel tomorrow as we're recording this, Jamie XX's album is on my albums of the year, so I fucking love that album. It is amazing. I'm picking that because it's a stellar record. It's beautiful.
Okay. John, you agree with that?
Though? You think it will win, though? I want to know before I answer.
Wait, are we doing that for the pick?
Hold on. Let John. I'm curious to hear what you think.
Probably not, because it didn't have... I feel like it didn't have as much exposure over here as, like, some of the other records on the list.
Yeah, no, I mean the personal pick. Like, not the prediction.
Oh, yeah, well, he's going for... I haven't even said mine yet. No, I'm going Born in the Echoes by the Chemical Brothers. That's my personal pick. It was a really solid record, just like In Color was. And In Color is still something that I listened to it about 2 weeks ago when I was prepping for my best albums of the year, and I still really enjoy that record. I've heard a lot of albums in 2015, so it didn't quite make the cut. I'm about to update the video description with some of my honorable mentions. I'll probably do that tomorrow, but that's definitely going to be one of them. I think that In Color stands a chance as a wild card for actually winning, though, even though Born in the Echoes is my personal choice. But I think... The Disclosure probably could take it.
Yeah, I think it's going to be Disclosure, honestly.
Like, I like Born in the Echoes, and I like Jamie XX's, and those two are, like, stellar records in comparison. Mm-hmm. So, like, yeah.
Those would be your two. That'd be your two top choices, but you go with In Color. I'm going to say Born in the Echoes, but I think we all agree that Disclosure will probably win.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, I'm thinking I'm going to put Jamie XX for this just because that's the only one that's on one of you guys' year-end lists.
Okay. Well, the Born in the Echoes was on his.
Yeah.
But didn't you say it was, like, really high on yours?
It's going to make the video and not my published list on Rate Your Music, so yes.
Oh. There's
it's
pretty high. I mean, mine was Chemical Brothers got number 12 on my list, so that's pretty high.
And what's on yours, Johnny? What's In Color
it's
on yours?
Number 11. It's number 11, actually.
You win by just a hair.
Wow.
Like, I'm not even joking.
I put an electronic album at number 11, not number 12.
Okay. So let's get into the stuff that our demographic really cares about. Best rock performance.
Electronic shit. They're not real instrumentalists. Yeah. They don't know how to play a guitar.
They just press a button. Who cares about composition skills? I just want guitar wankery.
We're
insulting our audience.
We love our audience.
Please like and subscribe.
Best rock performance, Mark?
Yeah, so it's between Don't Want to Fight by Alabama Shakes. By the way, Alabama Shakes, like, I think they got like 9 nominations. So.
Mm.
Yeah, they're definitely killing it in the rock game.
They are.
Yeah. Don't Want to Fight, What Kind of Man by Florence and the Machine, Something from Nothing by Foo Fighters, X's and O's by Elk King, and Moaning Lisa Smile by Wolf Alice. Gee, I wonder which one you're going to pick, John.
Moaning Lisa Smile, are you kidding me? No competition. Just kidding.
I know.
There's actually a lot of competition here, but there's no way. Honestly, I was ecstatic when I heard this. That was actually the first thing I heard about Grammy nominations, because Maddie from the 1975 tweeted that Wolf Alice got nominated for a Grammy, and I was like, what? Wolf Alice got nominated for something in America, even though they're not that big? So, obviously, Moaning Lisa Smile, have to give it to it. It's a really interesting song. It was written from the point of view of Lisa Simpson from The Simpsons, so, and her growing up. I just thought that was a really interesting perspective.
You know, I can see a smile that becomes sentient and moans on its own is like a bad latter season Simpsons episode. So,
yes, good in a while. But
now personally, I think that just because you're so passionate about it, we're gonna give this Moaning Lisa Smile for the choice. Yeah. But I would probably go either What Kind of Man or Something from Nothing.
I would go with Something from Nothing out of the two, because Something from Nothing is like, it's like, personally, even though I love Wasting Lads, my favorite Foo Fighters album, Something from Nothing is the best Foo Fighters song I've heard in a long time. That song is amazing.
Yeah, and of course,
did you hear the EP?
Yeah, and of course, what I remember in that second episode of the podcast, going back to that, when I was hanging out with John, we were going over pet peeves, and one of them, Something from Nothing, kind of going full circle, I was talking about how people don't know how chords work because they're calling it a ripoff of Holy's Ivor for that part that just has a somewhat similar strumming pattern. And I just hate that. So I kind of want to make that my choice just out of spite. But okay, we're gonna give it to Wolf Al. So we're gonna give it to Wolf Alice, and then the prediction. Who do you think it's gonna be?
Foo Fighters.
Foo Fighters.
I think it will. Obviously, I would love for an underdog win to happen for Wolf Alice. You know, it happens. Hailstorm won a Grammy.
They didn't deserve it.
Yeah.
Which is awesome.
And we're gonna go to get to Best Metal Performance in a little bit. And actually, I like that they just made it Best Metal Performance. So Hailstorm wouldn't be able to win, even though I like that song. But
but
that wasn't best hard, metal.
Yeah.
That was. Oh, and one more thing about this category. Please don't let it be X's and O's. I hate that song.
I don't hate it. It's just annoying. You know.
That's more accurate. Because who thinks she's likable in that song? I don't get it. Best metal performance. So we've got I think that this is kind of an improvement over the past year because it's actually like it's not. I'm gonna go over it first. So it's Identity by August Burns Red, Cerise Citrus by Ghost, 512. Running jokes. 512 by Lamb of God. Thank You by Seven Dust and Custer by Slipknot. Now, I just like that it's actually all artists that have been around less than 30 years.
You're not giving it all to the Judas Priest.
And not just like doing like a live version of a song from 25 years ago and cheating like that.
Yeah. And then of course it like somehow wins.
Yeah.
That's always frustrating.
So, are we gonna agree on Ghost?
As for personal pick or for who will win?
In general, like for either of them.
I don't think that they'll win. I think Lamb of God is gonna.
Yeah,
win.
I mean, I love Ghost a lot, and I do love the Lamb of God record too. I want Ghost to win, but knowing how good the Lamb of God record is and how popular they are, I think that's gonna win.
And you know there is that kind of story, that kind of a backstory to it about how Randy went through all that crap after her last album and although I really want it to be Ghost, not just because it's my favorite out of these, but just so I can see their acceptance speech.
Pop it up on stage, laying it down. I hope he does that thing where he just like puts his hand up and then like points at people in the audience, like points at Taylor Swift or something. And she's like, oh,
he just points at her and smiles. He just points at her and smiles.
And the Grammy just like levitates and goes into his hand.
I said like they actually do rig a guy with like a string on like the rafters to like move it like the levitate it.
Okay, so we're agreeing. Our choice is Ghost, but predictions Lamb God.
Yes, although Slipknot, I would say that I like that track, but I'm gonna go with Ghost still because I like that one a little bit more.
Okay, Best Rock Song, Don't Wanna Fight by Alabama Shakes, X and O's, Hold Back the River by James Bay, Lydia by Highly Suspect, and What Kind of Man?
I like seeing Florence wrapping up these Grammy noms. That's pretty cool.
Can we do for James Bay what we did for Wolf Alice in yours, John?
I'm down with that.
A whole lot, so I know how big of a fan you were. I think that it actually stands a shot at winning, but I think what kind of man, or else X's and O's, will probably what wins. Unfortunately, as much I don't know.
I mean, I think this is the one that Alabama Shakes to take, honestly.
Yeah, it seems like it's right up their alley. You know, best rock song, and you know, what's her, Brittany Howard? Is that the? She's got a great voice. It's a really solid song. I think that it could definitely take it, but I'm gonna go with Mark on this for "Hold Back the River" for personal choice.
I'm definitely gonna agree.
Okay,
with you guys, "Hold Back the River."
Okay, so James Bay for a choice and Alabama Shakes for a prediction. But now best rock album. Oh, by the way, Highly Suspect, like that's kind of a weirdly underground like, pick. Like, they're not that well known. I'm surprised by that.
We've had a couple of Grammy noms.
Yeah. Best Rock Album, Chaos in the Calm by James Bay. Kintsugi by Death Cab for Cutie. Highly Suspect, again, Mr. Asylum. Drones.
Yeah.
This is the one that John and I are at odds with. And
I'm on Mark's side.
And 0.5 degrees.
I'm a cover filler on my side.
You know, this is what we were talking about with Kintsugi, and might as well talk about it now before we get into anything else. I'm catching up on Death Cab's discography now, I'm enjoying Kintsugi. Not really like year-end list material for me, but it's good.
Yeah, it's very good. There's a lot of different sounds on there. Yeah.
And one thing that I mentioned to him, like probably I think earlier today, is that there is this trend of like every new album needs to have that token like 80s or disco or both song on it. And well, it's not always a bad thing. And it can sometimes be one of my favorite songs on the album. Kintsugi, like I called them on a couple of these songs Disco Cab for Groovy, and it crosses a line for me. Like, no, Death Cab for Cutie cannot do a disco, dance, funk, like, 80s, no!
They can't? Because they did, Mark, and it's on the album, I've heard it.
Just because you can, you didn't stop to think about whether or not you should.
Are you referring to everything to feeling, or Good Help is So Hard to Find? Like
both.
Both? Have you
heard? I haven't heard Kintsugi. No, so I'm completely out of the loop with this one.
Okay, I've heard nothing from before. Me and Mark went at it here with our disagreements, yeah, but I think
you're good.
I think that it fits. Honestly, I'm a fan of whenever these token 80s leaning tracks pop up, just because I'm kind of a sucker for 80s music.
I am again sometimes, but it's gotta. It's like when The Fray puts a random disco song in the middle of their album, like they did recently.
That didn't work. You're right.
Yeah. And by the way, I've been catching one more thing. I have been catching up on, like, I basically heard all their albums since Transatlanticism at this point, and I'm definitely a fan
of everything.
I mean, only thing is, I'm not that much of a fan of Narrow Stairs.
There's some really good songs on there, like
I'll Possess Your Heart, No Sunlight, Cath.
Yeah.
But it gets almost self-parody levels of like self-pity and trying to be heartstringy. I don't know.
No Sunlight was a really pleasant song, though. I thought that was
like, really. I think I'm one of the few people that likes Codes and Keys more, just because it's like, he's really good at writing pop hooks, and he does that really well on that.
Yeah, so. That album was great. There's no that album was very underrated. A lot of people were just so mad and upset that it went for more of this pop appeal, but.
But it's like, he wasn't
they're
sad.
They're supposed to be not. They're supposed to be sad. It's Dead Cat for Cutie. I want to cry. I want to sing along.
Oh, God. You sound like some of the people I saw in the comments.
Hey, I mean, I'm just speaking for the people.
That's right. That's what you're here for, Johnny.
I don't care if you're married to Zooey Deschanel. You should still be sad for some reason.
Yeah, exactly.
Don't be quirky.
That's what they want.
Don't you dare pick up that ukulele.
That's what people are going to be saying about 21 Pilots in 10 years. Like, why aren't you guys sad or depressed or anything anymore? All of your songs are just happy or content.
Stop making money!
I feel like a couple people said that about, like, Tear My Heart, when they were like, oh, why can't every song be like that one really sad piano ballad on Regional at Best?
Yeah, God knows that's what I wanted out of the record. I'm so disappointed.
Okay, anyway... So Grammys.
Yeah.
My pick, obviously Chaos in the Calm, but I mean I'd be open to Kintsugi. What do you guys think?
Drones.
No.
We agree on all of these guys. We don't have to agree. We don't have to be uniform.
But Drones is terrible. Well, it's not terrible. It's just kind of
it's subpar.
But the good news is that the good news is that you're not Drones by having your own mindset. You're picking your own record, so you didn't become
one of the people
you survived to listen.
And we can revolt against your opinion.
Yeah, 2 out of 5. David reference.
I will go with Chaos in the Calm, if only because I haven't heard Kintsugi or Mr. Asylum, and I didn't like the Gray Chapter that much as well.
Yay!
Gray Chapter, it faded for me with time. I really liked it at first, but I've come back to it a few times, and it's just, I mean, there's some really great tracks, but there's not...
Yeah.
I don't know. There's not as much that grabbed me. Like, right off the bat, I was like, yeah, Slipknot's back. Okay, I'm really grooving with this. And there's some really hard-hitting moments, and then there are moments like Rain Is What You Want, I think, is the title of, like, one of the last songs on the album that I thought was a really good way to close it out. But
mm-hmm.
there's some moments in there that dragged, and that's for sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes. So, and do you think that I wouldn't be surprised. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if Muse won it.
Yeah.
Oh no, I wouldn't be surprised at all.
Yeah, I think they're gonna win actually.
All right.
And I mean, on one hand, it's nice to have Muse win a Grammy.
Yeah.
But
it's with drones.
I know.
Not with Absolution or Black Holes or fucking.
I mean, it'd be one thing if it was best song for Mercy or Dead Inside, but.
Dead Inside. Yeah, I would have liked to have seen a nomination for that, but yeah, I don't know, guys. Still having fun with it.
At least it's not best song nomination for Psycho.
No.
Okay, that's what it would
we
be.
We all agree that that's a terrible song, right?
Yes, it's the worst song they've ever done.
I wouldn't go that far, but it's pretty bad.
No. What do you think is the worst?
I like the riffs and the instrumental on it. I mean,
probably something off the Second Law. I'm sorry.
Boy, you're crazy.
The Second Law is actually. I think
everyone is crazy.
I think the Second Law is worse than Drones, but it's especially following the Resistance. Like that's a huge drop in quality. But Drones was more consistent, so I liked it a little more for that reason.
You know what? I've accepted that I'm just like the buzz. I'm just hearing a different album than everyone else when I listen.
Can we all just agree that this is a good one, though? Can we agree that Black Hole?
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Thank you for the visual aid to this podcast, by the way.
Yes, of course. I don't know if you're doing video or not this time, so that's why I said the name out loud.
Yeah.
Like, for me, they just drop off after Absolution, but they drop off a little bit after Black Holes, because I think Resistance is okay.
That's my least favorite album from them, if I'm being honest.
Really?
Yeah. Resistance.
Really?
Yeah. Didn't care for all of the, the part three, the...
Exogenesis? That was great.
I didn't care
for
it.
But it's their Queen album.
Yeah, that's what I didn't like.
You not like Queen?
It felt too... I don't know. It felt like they almost got drowned in the influence of it for me. I mean, I really love songs like Undisclosed Desires. That's great.
Yeah, and really friggin'... like the Resistance. I'm going to go on a huge Muse bend after this podcast, by the way. I should just say.
Yeah, I need to as well.
Okay, so best alternative album.
Yeah.
Sound and Color by Alabama Shakes. Vulnicura by Björk, as I've recently learned it's pronounced. Not Björk, Björk. Two syllables.
Björk.
Björk.
Yeah. The Waterfall by My Morning Jacket. Currents by Tame Impala. And Star Wars by Wilco.
Star Wars.
Now this is weird because last year I'd heard pretty much every one of the albums I was nominated. This year I haven't heard any of them yet.
You haven't heard any of these records?
No, and the only one that's like on my list right now is My Morning Jacket.
You haven't heard Current?
Really?
And Paula?
Nope.
Man,
I didn't get around to it.
Oh man, no.
I wanted to.
No.
I was just kind of avoiding it because of hype. Like, internet hype. It's one of those records I just didn't care to check out.
No.
When I was going through my pins recently, I didn't check out. Like, I had a list of albums I was checking out, I wanted to check out, and all of these were on there, but I didn't check out Currents. I rather checked out Cherry Bomb by Tyler, the Creator.
Actually, you know why I didn't check it out?
Why?
Because I'm a man, and I can make my own decisions.
Mm.
I
think all of the Tame Impala fans will get a good laugh out of that one, Mark. Stick around next week. Mark's going to have plenty of other jokes.
thank you. Hey, it's my channel. I can make all the bad puns I want.
Currents is my pick, for sure. I absolutely love that record. I was a huge fan Well, I've been a fan of pretty much everything they've released at this point. Bonerism was a really solid record all the way through. Currents was more electronic, more synthy, but Kevin Parker made it work.
Yeah. I wouldn't be personally, if I was going to predict from an unbiased point of view, I'd say either Tim Paula or maybe even Bjork.
Bjork.
Yeah, I could see Bjork winning only because longevity.
Yeah. The legacy.
Legacy. I'm gonna side with the internet and John and just say Currents would be my go-to pick because it does have a lot of that. A lot of people like it, and I mean the collective consciousness has got to be right on something in that regard. So
yeah.
Because Tim Paul for both the choice and the prediction. Now I just know something. The Grammys is weird because Alabama Shakes is nominated for Best Rock Song. But they're not nominated for Best Rock Album. They're nominated for Best Alternative Album. How does that work?
I don't know why it's being categorized like that, honestly.
Because they're alternative, Mark.
They don't follow the standards of the norm of your society, your utopian society. We don't have to live by your rules. They can be alternative. They can be R&B.
They're not.
They can be metal.
They're not.
They can be jazz. They can be dubstep.
They could be jazz.
They can.
They want to be.
They're Alabama Shakes. Okay.
They shake from one genre to the next.
Like honestly, how dare you try to categorize them? Like how dare you, sexist, feminine,
cis lord,
feminine, feminist.
Too much. Putting down the female pointed band. I see.
Sorry.
Yeah. Best R&B performance.
Yeah,
we're
skipping that. We're skipping that. We're skipping best traditional R&B because we don't know anything. Best R&B song, skipping that. Best Urban Contemporary, whatever the hell that is. Best R&B album, whatever. Best rap performance. So we got apparently by J. Cole, Back to Back by Drake. Not even an album song, just like a diss song. He's that controlling of everything.
Yeah, somehow they forgot to submit Hotline Bling.
Yeah, but they made it a top priority to submit Back to Back.
It's because they were trying to call Drake on his cell phone and he was waiting for somebody else to call. That's why
they needed his love.
Wait, when you need my nom.
Need my nom.
Okay, Trap Queen by Fettuccine Wap.
Fettuccine.
All Right and Truffle Butter.
Ugh.
And All Day by Kanye West. Featuring Theophilus London, Alan Kingdom, and Paul McCartney somewhere.
Yeah.
He's on there. It's ambiguous.
I think he played like a background like guitar part or vocal harmony or something.
Yeah, makes perfect sense to have him just like sit super low in the mixing, one vocal part when you get a freaking Beatle.
Yeah. Yeah, that makes sense. I mean, if you're going to feature him, why not make it in the most minimal role possible?
Okay, so anyway, it's all right.
All right.
Yeah, all right.
I think that it... All right. I don't know if it will win. I'm not sure. I hope it will win.
What if it's Fetty?
No, guys, Trap Queen.
Yeah, exactly. I honestly, unfortunately, think that Fetty stands a chance. I mean, like, I don't mind that song at all. I think it's a pretty good song, but I don't think it's deserving of it by any means.
But it's not all right.
It is all right.
Are we gonna make that for the prediction?
Trap Queen or for All Right.
For Fetty.
I think the Fetty. Yeah, it's not my choice, but it's my prediction.
I think the Fettuccine Wap Fredo is gonna win.
Yeah, and you know, I think it's the kind of thing that because if Kendrick wins all the other ones we're predicting he's gonna win, then him losing one isn't gonna be the end of the world.
Yeah, but
although it will not make any sense.
It's
but
such
if he
a
doesn't
good
win.
Performance, though. What's a shame?
No, it's best song.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean that's my favorite song on the album. So
wait a minute. We have it for our prediction for song of the year. Oh wait, no, this is for best rap performance.
Yeah.
Performance. Yeah. That's Kendrick. Yeah.
Yeah. Rap song though. We
got to. Yeah. So we're gonna let's just give it to Kendrick for prediction.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I misread that. Sorry. So best rap song collaboration, One Man Can Change the World by No 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 featuring Kanye West and John Legend. Glory by Common and John Legend.
I thought that was going to be Glory by Lil Wayne for a second.
A Classic Man by Jay Denna featuring Roman Keon Arthur. Please don't let it be that.
No,
if there was the Kendrick version, yes. Because his verse on that is amazing.
Well, these walls.
These walls, then. The next choice.
Featuring Bilal and Wiz and Thundercat. Yes.
Exactly.
And only.
Ugh.
By The Scourge.
The crew.
But at least we know she never fucked Wayne or Drake.
Fuck Drake.
But Drake is first in line.
I never fucked Drake.
But the funny thing is that she left her guy and then just ended up getting with Meek. So.
That's how life goes, you know.
That's how it be.
You miss the Drake train and you catch Meek.
So we're doing Kendrick for both the choice and prediction.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's the only real choice here.
I mean, seriously. God,
if Nicki won this, I would...
That would be the riot.
Yeah, there'd be some riots. If Nicki
wins, at least it's not Classic Man or Big Sean. That's how I would view it.
Yeah. Here's the thing. Classic Man is probably the worst song objectively, but only makes me more frustrated.
Yeah. Just because it's four people being awful,
and it was actually in the top half of the Hot 100.
Yeah,
but like Classic Man is literally a song of nothing, and the video is like, I don't even know. Like I can't even describe how the video is like backwards offensive towards its own, like towards it. Just I don't understand. That video is so weird and the song is so bland.
Yeah,
it's basically the male fancy.
It is.
Yeah,
and I when it's the same beat.
Describe it that way. Yeah.
Hopefully after the Grammy, after he loses this, like that's the last time anyone will freaking mention Jai Denna.
Yeah.
So best rap song. All Day with a crap ton of names listed.
Yeah, it took that many people to make that possible, really.
It took all day.
Set my man up. He knew to come through.
You know what? That pun was all right. The next nominee. Hey, you know, with all these puns, I'm probably making a lot of enemies. Got a lot of enemies. Energy is the next nominee.
Oh.
Yeah, oh.
Then
Glory.
And Glory by Common and John Legend. That's kind of like a placeholder one. I think it's gonna be all right though.
You mentioned Trap Queen. You didn't mention
Trap Queen. Yeah.
Trap Queen is. Oh, it is not. For some reason, I didn't scroll down.
Yeah.
You know what? I think that's gonna. You want? Is that gonna be the prediction?
I don't know, man. You know, sometimes I hit the strip with my Trap Queen. I don't know. I feel it. I feel this song. It could be my personal choice. But no, I'm gonna have to go with All Right.
I still want All Right to win, but I actually think Fetty Wap might take that one.
Okay, so Kendrick for the choice and Fetty, our good boy Fetty. Pray for Fetty.
I don't know. I think Drake has a chance here.
Yeah,
I like Energy. I do.
I
wouldn't be surprised if he did come away with one, but... Yeah.
It's not going to be back-to-back. Back-to-back's not going to win a Grammy.
Oh, yeah, no.
If anything wins, it's going to be Energy, and I would like to see it. I don't know. This category, I would be okay with Energy winning here.
So do you want to put Drake for the choice, then?
Yes, I want Drake for my choice, and as far as what I think will win, I have to say Trap Queen.
Yeah, so Drake and Fetty. Got it.
Yep.
Best Rap Album, 2014 Forest Hills Drive by J. Cole, Compton by Dr. Dre. Hey, that's your boy, that's your namesake.
Yeah.
If you're reading This Is Too Late by Drizzy, it's Pimp Butterfly and Pink Print. Pimp Butterfly, we all know it.
T-Bat.
Right.
I have to give a shout out. I have to give a quick shout out to 2014 Forest Hills Drive's really, really good group going on in that. I really enjoyed it because it was mainly narrative and there was no features on there. So I just
you know what? I've tried getting into J. Cole. I haven't listened to any of his full albums, but I probably should. But I don't know. He's always kind of underwhelmed me. I don't know.
I felt the same way.
Can I extend a parallel that a certain music reviewer made about J. Cole recently?
Yes.
Mr. Fantan called J. Cole and Kendrick he kind of described them as this generation's Mos Def and Talib. I agree with that wholeheartedly, and I would say that Kendrick is to Def, Mos Def, for what J. Cole is to Talib. Talib's a little bit harder to get into for some people. So I would say that if you gave him a chance, though, he would be really fulfilling. You would get a lot out of his stuff.
Right, and that's what I'm saying. I felt the same way as Mark did at first, but then I actually checked out beyond the singles, you know, and I actually started playing his records, getting ready for Forest Hill Drive, and I think that I'm clicking with 2014 the most, but I think that he's still got a pretty solid discography. Born Center was really good.
See, I don't get your comparison because I'm but a youngin', but...
Predict.
Yeah. So Kendrick for both prediction and the choice?
Yes. Even though Drake stands a chance.
Okay. Now, I just kind of want to briefly say best country album we're going to get Casey Musgraves, please.
What are the nominees?
Sam Hunt, Little Big Town, Ashley Monroe, Casey Musgraves, and Chris Stapleton.
Yeah, definitely personal choice. Pageant Material was number 14 on my top albums of the year. Really, really like it.
I wouldn't be surprised. I might put that for depression because he ended up like sweeping the Country Music Awards, apparently.
Yeah, I think that there's too much hype behind Chris Stapleton right now, though. I think that's a lot of, it's not that he's not good, but this record is not game-changing. You know, it's not something that is just, I don't know, changing the world of country music. Yes, it's a move in the right direction, and I like most of it. It's just that it's not something that I would throw on all the time. So I have to say choice and prediction to Casey Musgraves.
Okay. Casey Musgraves. I'm
going to have to side with John. I was gone for the last, like, 2-3 minutes because I was dropped from the call.
Did you get that email, Johnny? It's the same one that I got a few weeks ago whenever I was dropped from the podcast.
I think that is what happened. I think I was fired mid-podcast.
Not sure how you got back in, but, yeah.
Awkward. But I dropped it at the proper time because I don't know crap about country music. So.
All right. Yeah, that's why.
We don't either, but it's still a really good album.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, Pageant Material. I mean, I've heard, surprisingly, you'd be surprised, but I've heard 4 out of 5 of these records. The only one I didn't hear was Ashley Monroe.
Of all people?
I listen to these albums, man. I don't review them, but I'll at least give them a play or two.
And you're saying your choice is Sam Hunt?
Yeah, I was just so impressed with the songwriting of House Party. It changed my life.
Yeah, that album took a lot of your time.
It actually, I think I only made it like 3/4 of the way through that one before I turned it off.
Okay, so the next one, we're just gonna blaze through a bunch of these. So best new age, best improvised jazz solo, best jazz.
Oh, yeah, I definitely have a prediction for that.
Jimmy Green or John Scofield for just best jazz instrumental album.
Oh man, it's just such a hard choice. I don't know.
Before we do move from the jazz, I am upset that the Epic was not nominated for a jazz because that album is freaking amazing.
Kamari Washington, right? Is that right?
Kamasi Washington.
That album is astounding, and I'm so sad that it did not get a Grammy nod.
Oh yeah, and because he's kind of made people like outside Bad Bad Not Good like really care about jazz again. I haven't listened to it because triple album, but
yeah, I haven't either.
It's amazing and totally worth your time.
It's like the Here Lies Music review just says it all.
Yeah,
I don't remember it, so I'll have to look that up.
It's great, but it's 3 hours. Who's got time for that?
Oh yeah, I think I said same in the comments.
Yeah,
yeah. I only have time for his 10-second review.
Yeah. Okay, so gospel, Christian rock, ew.
No,
coming from Christian, ew. Blues, folk. Pardon Misty was not nominated for folk, by the way. Best folk album.
His label might not have submitted it, honestly.
Yeah. Best score, Birdman, Imitation Game, Interstellar 3.
Birdman was stellar. Birdman and Interstellar were both great.
The score?
Probably Whiplash, if I'm going to go with Whiplash, if I'm going to go with one.
Haven't
Whiplash,
seen it.
So you guys want... I'll put a roll for that.
Oh, Whiplash is so good.
I really want to see that because it seems like it'd be... I know I would think it's incredible, but I just haven't gone around to it yet.
I've got it downloaded. This inspired me. I'm going to watch it in the next week. I'm going.
So that score to. Soundtrack. So are we going to say Whiplash for the pick and prediction?
Do we all have to have the same choice?
I don't know. We're never going to win.
I want Interstellar as my choice.
Okay,
I'll go with Interstellar because it was the... Yeah, we'll go with Interstellar.
I actually haven't seen any of these movies yet. So.
Oh, okay.
So I might go back and watch that. Who knows? Okay, so this is the one I was actually scrolling down to. Best song written for visual media. Earned It for 50 Shades of Grey. Glory, again, for some reason. Love Me Like You Do by Ellie Goulding. See You Again. And Till It Happens to You by Lady Gaga and Diane Warren.
That was a pretty powerful song, honestly. I didn't expect it, but it talks about a pretty important issue. I'm not that I would care that much about any of these songs, but I mean, I would go with Lady Gaga's track for hopefully the win and my personal choice.
So what is the next one? By the way, these categories are getting smaller and smaller. We can acknowledge that. So best now, I do want to go down to best arrangement, instrumental, and vocals, because David Bowie's song "Sue" or "In a Season of Crime" is nominated, and yes. Best Recording Package, Florence and the Machine's nominated for that.
Why?
I mean...
Best Recording Package, like I guess just liner notes.
And actually, Father John Misty is nominated for one of
them. Yeah, best box for Special Limited Edition Package.
Yeah.
And these are
really specific Grammys. Wow.
And Father John Misty really deserves it for that, because that deluxe vinyl thing, I have it, and I screwed up by breaking the little music box thing. For when you open it, it plays something, but I screwed up and broke that.
I don't have the deluxe limited edition one. Aww.
Yep, it was like $40.
I only got this boring one. It was like $19.99.
Yeah. Okay. So we're gonna do Florence for recording package. Father John.
What kind of man wouldn't pick that?
And if he doesn't win that, then we're gonna all be that's going to be the night Josh Tillman threw a ride at the Grammys.
That will make an epic sequel. I'm just saying it right now on his next record.
Okay.
I just love the kind of producer.
The Decemberists are nominated for the limited edition package. I don't have that, though, so.
I don't either. I couldn't comment on that.
Okay, and two other ones real quick. Producer of the Year, Jeff Basker is nominated for that. He worked on Uptown Special and Grand Romantic from Nate Ruiz and a bunch of good stuff. So you want to do that?
Yeah, I think I could go with that because I think he did a pretty good job with Make It Sound.
The only thing is that Diplo is also nominated. I'm afraid he's going to win.
Diplo.
He'll probably win.
Of course, his first credit, is Bitch, I'm Madonna.
Oh, God. That was Diplo?
Yeah.
I forgot. Yeah.
He did the zipper sound.
That's what it was, yeah. I think I said that in our review, didn't I? Yeah,
everyone said that.
I said it was like a bunch of jeans getting unzipped.
But we're just going to say Jeff Basker is going to win, please. And the last one, it's actually the last thing listed here, best music video.
Oh, okay.
So there's LSD by ASAP Rocky, I Feel Love Every Million Miles by The Dead Weather, All Right, Bad Blood, and Freedom by Pharrell Williams. I'm going to say All Right.
Easily, I Feel Love for me. Love the music video for that. Not that I don't like All Right, but I Feel Love's music video. I don't know, I just thought it was really cool in the way they shot it and everything. And it seemed like there was a lot of effort.
But guys, Selena Gomez, Taylor Swift, SmackDown! Oh!
Oh, yeah. It's just like we threw 100 names on it so that a lot of people would watch it.
And and each of them gets like a max, and all of them except three get like a max 3 seconds of screen time.
Basically, it's an entire it's an entire video of like names popping up on screen, like Selena Gomez as and then she does nothing like in the video. Like,
dude, what do they do aside from just having names?
Look at the camera.
Look, yeah, they look boldly at the camera, and then Kendrick raps in the background.
And then that one.
No, you guys don't understand. That's Taylor Swift's homage to Too Many Cooks.
Oh yeah, I'm sure there was that much.
Yes, yes. I love that.
Yeah.
So are we? Let's just say I feel love for the choice and all right for the prediction. You think?
Yeah.
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 Oh. And that's it. This took way too long, but here we go. Okay, and with all that out of the way, we're probably going to do like an update thing after the Grammys come on, just to see how right we were or wrong, realistically. Watch this, Kendrick gets two. And our big topic, real quick, because John, you have to go, we're going to be talking about going down the albums we're looking forward to for the first part of 2016. Now, disclaimer here, these are only like confirmed releases with dates and names and stuff, not Tool and Metallica and Brand New.
Yeah, I've been hearing Tool for the past 10 years almost, so...
Yeah.
And so do you guys have like lists put together?
Yeah, I've got a...
Yeah, I mean, I have a small list.
So how many do you guys have written down?
I've got 4.
Yeah, I've got about 3.
Okay, I have 11. So I'm just gonna go down mine and see if we have any. I'm just gonna go down mine and see if we have any overlap.
Okay.
And I got something for basically every week of the first couple months. So on January 8th we got David Bowie's Black Star. That first single is like all the hype you need. Like.
Yeah.
Holy crap. Then Panic at the Disco. Death of a Bachelor on the 15th of January. Thoughts?
No, it's not on mine. Yeah. I'm not the biggest Panic fan though.
Yeah, I'm gonna check it out, but like DCD2 marketing is just getting to me.
Yeah, I can't not check it out just because my viewers would go crazy if I didn't. But
right. It'd be like when Other Mark didn't cover Rebel Heart in like every video. There were five comments about it for the rest of the year.
Exactly. So it's not on my list, though, but yeah, I'm definitely going to be hearing it.
Okay, then the next week, on the 22nd, be Megadeth's Dystopia. Really hope it's better than Super Collider.
It wasn't on my list of anticipated, but it's one that I'll be listening to because, again, Super Collider was crap.
But it had some good songs on it, but it was so bogged down.
Yeah.
Yeah. Then the week after that, on 29th, Block Party Hymns. I hope the rest of it doesn't sound like The Love Within.
Yeah, that's on my
after
list.
That single.
Yeah. I think it was something that I mean, it's still on my list, but I don't know if I'm that hyped for it. I just heard the single a couple of days ago, so.
Yeah. Then the week after that, February 5th, Elton John's putting out an album. Might check that out. Mm-hmm. Week after that, on the 12th, we got The Frights.
I've
talked about them on this channel. I've interviewed them. John, we know they're bases.
No, we can't reveal his secret identity.
No, he's never made it a secret.
Oh, he has. He's never openly said it, so therefore it's a secret.
That's just neutral.
So what do you got for the next week?
Okay. Animal Collective, the week after that.
That's all mine.
That one's on mine. Yeah,
that Flor Da Da song, Dim Ahead.
So catchy, it's so damn catchy. It's gonna be on songs on your list. Like, it came out at the end of November, I know, but there's no way that I can't not put that on my top songs of the year list just because I fell in love with it, like instantly.
Yeah, and as one of those people as one of the few people that actually like really enjoy Panda Beer Meets the Grim Reaper, I'm all in. Mm. I mean, it's not gonna be on your end list, but you know. Then the week after that, Anthrax, For All Kings, going back to the metal.
That's on my list because I love their last record, and I'm interested to see how they do it with a different guitarist. I'm excited to see how they come together with it.
Yeah, and see if they can live up to that comeback. Because in a way that's more interesting than the comeback record is the follow-up to the comeback record, because you don't know if they're going to sustain that.
Exactly.
You know, it's kind of like listening to, we're going back to Panic at the Disco, like that old scene, like American Beauty, American Psycho versus Save Rock and Roll, which I thought was a big drop-off from Save Rock and Roll. So, really interesting.
Yeah.
And lastly, the most recently announced would be Brian Fallon from the Gaslight Anthem putting out a solo album on March 11th called Painkillers.
I did hear about that. I forgot about that.
Yeah, he put out the first single, and it's really good. It's obviously very Springsteen-y.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure what he does in that song they couldn't have done with the Gaslight Anthem, but I'm looking forward to it.
I think it's more of like the band's on break right now, and they need some time off. And Fallon's like, I'm ready to go. So.
Right. Okay. So which ones have I not talked about that you guys have on your list?
I got a couple of others that you didn't get to. A few of our choices lined up, but not that many. I've got Foxes on my list for I think it's the beginning of February. I didn't write down a date for it, but Foxes comes out. And it's gotten delayed a couple of times, but I was a pretty big fan of the lead single off of the record, and I thought that her debut album, Glorious, had some really stellar pop tunes on that, so it's definitely a pop singer from the UK that I'm excited about. Wolf Mother has a new album coming out.
Although, are you excited for it given how their last album sounded?
I liked the sound of their last record. You're talking about
really?
The one that came out in 2014. Right?
Yeah, New 13? Crown, yeah.
Yeah, I really liked that album. Yeah, I gave it a very positive review, honestly. I liked, there were some really good songs on there that hit with me, like Tangerine Dream, or My Tangerine Dream. I don't know, it was a little bit different, but I don't know, I'm excited for this one. I haven't heard any songs off of it yet. I don't know if they've released anything, but I know.
I don't know if they have, coming. But...
And I've got one more, I think, the 1975, and their record... I'm going to have to read the title off of the screen because it's so long. I like it.
I watch you when you... Oh, sorry, go ahead.
Mark.
I'm sorry. I was trying to make
a joke. I like it when you sleep, for you are so beautiful, yet so unaware of it. And that's coming out at the end of February. And
I don't like that name.
Well, I like it when you're quiet, for you are so silent, yet so aware of it.
Continue.
I heard the new song off of this, and that's what really got me. Love Me was good, I thought. I don't know if you guys have heard that single.
No, I haven't.
It charted at the bottom of the Hot 100, which was pretty cool. Their fan base has been growing rapidly, and it was kind of cool to see them working their way up the charts. But the second single, Ugh, is, I know, stupid title, but... They don't say Ugh in the song, so.
it's not like that Nate Ruiz song where the whole chorus is, ah! That's the first thing I thought of.
Yeah, no, it's not that. It's not that at all. It's a really, like, there's a lot going on, but it sounds really, really clean, and it's just kind of, once again, kind of groovy and disco dipped, if you will. I know that's going to be an issue potentially for Mark, but it's just got, like, I don't know. It's like I feel like I should be wearing a bow tie, like dancing in like a disco club while I listen to it, and I'm on board with that.
John, it's because he's too young to understand. It's just not his style anymore.
Yeah,
it's not,
I mean, like,
his style's too faded.
You're acting like you guys grew up in that era?
Yeah.
You grew up with freaking, like, new metal.
No, and... why do you think we bonded over 1989, the album? Because,
like,
You guys bond over NSYNC.
The only song you guys didn't mention that is on my list that's on neither of yours, and it's a covers album.
Oh.
It's coming out in February. It's Ninja Sex Party's covers album. It's all 80s songs, and from what I've heard, it sounds amazing because they're having this Canadian synth group do the instrumentals, and they mesh so well together, and I'm so excited for it.
That sounds sick.
Now, one little quick thing I want to say about the 1975, like, I like what I've heard from them, but I feel like I'm the only one that thinks, like, they have this weird image that doesn't fit their music, because...
Like the dark thing, the whole black thing.
Yeah, because, like, they try to be all mysterious and cryptic and stuff, but you listen to their music and it's just, like, harmless indie pop. Like,
well, they switched over to the color now, though, so... I mean, that's they kind of shed that image. I think they were trying to look for a way to do it, and I think segueing into a new album cycle was the perfect way to do that.
Yeah, but it's like they have these long artsy titles and like try to be and like with the whole social media blackout thing they did, like they're trying to act like they're more like I don't want to say like artsy or artistic, but like you know what I mean.
I think the word you're looking for, Mark, is pretentious.
Thank you.
Yeah. I'm not going to say that word.
Yeah. I think that some of their stuff can come off that way, but if you look at it from an outside perspective without really hearing the music itself or listening to the album, but I don't know. I'm going to let the music speak for itself. I'm still excited. Yeah. That's for sure.
Yeah, I might check it out, you know, if there's not really much else coming out. Okay, and anything else? John, you said that you got it going a little bit?
Yeah, I've actually one of my friends is coming over, and we're working on getting some new things installed at the new place. So, yeah, you might not have noticed, but I am in a new setting here. I got a new wall of music over yonder.
You know, I wanted to congratulate you for getting a new house. I didn't do that on Facebook, but I meant to congratulate you.
Thanks, man.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I appreciate that. And it's nice to know that I'm going to be somewhere where I don't have to be. I'm not going to worry about moving, hopefully, for a while, because I was just in a situation where I felt like I was moving every 6 months. So,
yeah,
nice to have that alleviated.
And with that, I think that's a good point to end this episode of Mad Sounds, guys. Leave comments with your thoughts on everything covered here, the categories to talk about, the Grammys. Again, picture linked in the description if you're curious, and along with the MP3 converter website.
Yep.
If you like have any like questions you want to ask for possible like discussion topics on future episodes, feel free to leave those in the comments down below. Hopefully, with us seemingly more free now. I don't know. I'm in finals week now, and I think I'm gonna be off until like the end of January. So maybe we'll be able to record more than once a month. That'd be nice.
Yeah.
Hopefully
we'll see you around the start of the new year.
And that's about it. We'll see you guys on the next episode of Mad Sounds. We still don't have a sign off.
We don't. Can we all like yawn simultaneously?
I just yawned.
He's not a saint. You missed it, Mark. Damn.
So you.
That's a good yawn.
Yawn Capella.
That was a damn good yawn. Probably my best of the year, 8 out of 10.